Okay, guys, let's see if everything works now. And let's see if we have a healthy stream on YouTube and Facebook, and then we're gonna start. So we're waiting for YouTube to pick up. And I think Facebook is online at the moment.
Yes.
So we're now waiting for YouTube. And let me see why YouTube doesn't work. Okay, it seems that live dashboard is offline, so we're going to start that up again. And we are also live on YouTube. Awesome. Hey guys, thank you so very much for joining us in this new episode of Digital Classroom. What is Digital Classroom? Digital Classroom is actually where I interact with you guys, you there, yes, you. What can you do during Digital Classroom? On Facebook, we have a live stream. On YouTube, we have a live stream. And during that live stream, you can ask questions. You can ask questions whatever you want. Just keep it civil. You can ask questions about business, social media. You can ask questions about what I do, how I do it, and of course, also why and what's the idea behind it. But you can also ask stuff about retouching, because today we're actually going to do a fashion shoot. We're going to do photo critiques. I have some really, really cool images that somebody sent me after seeing a Digital Classroom. That's going to be killer. And of course, we're going to answer all your questions. So thank you so very much for joining, guys. We're going to start our trailer so you actually know what you're looking at. And then we're going to start. And there we are. Now, if you don't follow my blog, by the way, which you should, it's on frankdorhoff.com. Let me show you where you can find my blog. So let's go here. So it's under there. I actually yesterday wrote a preliminary review. So it's not really a review, but it's a preliminary review. Hey, I'm Dutch. Sorry for my expressions. So what did I do? Well, if you go online at frankdorhoff.com, you can actually now see that we're talking about a new smartphone. Now, why a new smartphone? Very simple. This is my Note 8. Really like it. But somehow, when you look at the images, they are okay. And I always tell people like, okay, this is when I take my Sony A7 III. So it's great. Then there is this okay factor where you go like, well, I can leave my camera at home. I won't have those perfect images I have from my Sony, but it's okay. And then up until now, all my smartphones were actually in this area. In other words, you really need to bring a camera if you want great shots. But if you go like, hey, I just want proof that I was there, or you're just walking around, your smartphone will do just fine. However, we travel around a lot, and sometimes it's very, very frustrating to bring that camera. For example, a while ago, we were biking in Copenhagen, and you have your camera with you on your backpack, but if you see something beautiful, you have to take your backpack off, take out the camera, take the shot, put the camera back in the backpack, put the backpack on, and if it's hot, it's pretty sweaty. So not a perfect solution, but all those beautiful shots, you don't want to miss them. Now, Huawei is actually releasing a new camera, or it's a phone, but I always call it my camera phone because I always take pictures with it. But they're releasing now a new one that has 40 megapixels. And of course, 40 megapixels isn't 40 megapixels like we have at the Sony. But it's a huge sensor. It's twice as big as an iPhone, and it has high dynamic range, and it has pixel binding. So 10 megapixels for stunning dynamic range and night shots. So keep an eye out on my website for a review on that one. I'm really looking forward to that, because that will actually probably be my first camera with a smartphone instead of a smartphone with a camera. You saw that joke? There we go. So today we have our model Rosa. We have a lot of stuff to do. And, well, you guys asked for it, so we're going to do it. We're going to shoot against a white seamless backdrop. Ugh, I really don't like that. So I'm going to show you some really cool tricks you can do with white seamless. And why don't I like it? I don't know. It's just, it's done so many times. So I thought, you know what? I get so many questions about it. Let's do it once. And also show you some tricks that you can actually do with that white seamless. Because, well, that's actually the cool thing. You can do some really cool stuff with it. If you have any questions in between, feel free to ask, of course. And by the way, if you are not already subscribed to our YouTube channel, what? Do it now. Hit that like button and, of course, subscribe. Okay, let me see if there are any questions in between. Michael actually asked me, hey Frank, I always calibrate my Saucony L758 outside. Which temperature range will be good for that? Is there any advice possible with Celsius range? Really? I have no clue, dude, really. I always do it in the studio because then I have controlled lighting and I'm for sure that actually my lighting is correct and constant. If you go outside and there's a cloud in front of the sun, which in the Netherlands it's always, you have way too much fluctuations. Calibrating your light media, we're talking about 1/10 of an f-stop, because out of the box, it's already in the ballpark. It's not like it's 3 stops off. That would be ridiculous. Or take the ND filter off. Hey. But anyway, so it's about 1/10 or 2/10 of an f-stop. Please do that inside and don't do it with small strobes or speed lights for the very simple reason they also fluctuate. So if you have an okay strobe system, just fire the strobe at least 6 times. If there's any difference between those 6 exposures, forget about calibrating that light meter. Just use it as it was out of the box. Now, if you see that 6 exposures gives you exactly the same exposure every single time on the light meter, now calibrate your light meter. And again, it's only 1 or 2/10 of an f-stop, so don't worry about it too much. It's more like it's the freaky stuff that you can do with your light meter. That's actually pretty cool, because now you can tell people, hey, I'm a real professional. I have a calibrated light meter. Oh, there's a lot of questions coming in. I missed your demo at the photography show. I saw that you were flashing your lens to create some flare, but it also created some bokeh ball effects. Did you spray the lens with water? No. I never clean my lenses, and that's not a joke. That's the honest truth. I never clean my lenses, so there's always a little bit of dust on my lens, and it actually helps creating those beautiful balls. That sounds really weird. But anyway, it creates those lighting effects because... Let me put it this way. If you have dust on your lens and you light it directly, it will actually show up. Now, if you don't light it directly, in other words, if you just take a picture, there's no light hitting your lens, so those balls will actually not show up. So as soon as you use those lens flares, that's when you see those beautiful bokeh effects or bokeh, depending on what you want. But it's a really cool way of just creating some extra effects. And you can even make one part clean so that the face of your model is always nice and clean without those little bouquet areas on it. But it's just dust. And the best way to do it is just use... This kind of sounds ridiculous, but we tried it with different kind of things. But in the end, just house dust works the best. Just place your camera with the lens up and just let it sit there for 2 or 3 days so it gathers a little bit of dust and then it will work. We also tried it during a seminar where we actually got into problems because my lens was totally clean and it didn't work, of course, because the lens was clean. So we tried it with dust from a vacuumer. I kid you not, it's not a joke. Didn't work out at all. It just looked terrible and it just didn't work. I think it was too big, the particles. The particles were too big, that's what I mean. So house dust. Best way, and hey, it's free. I'm Dutch. Let me see if there are any other questions. Hey, Frank, good morning from California. Good morning, California. And somebody says, the review for this phone is really good. Good zoom and great low light situations. And that's what I want. I don't care about the 40 megapixels. I actually like that it can bind to 10 megapixels. So when I'm doing a behind the scenes shot, for example, for Digital Classroom or our social media, I actually get those beautiful, beautiful tones that you see in the backdrops instead of having a noisy mess. So that's why I'm really looking forward to that phone. Okay, Annemieke, do we have any questions on Facebook?
Let's try the mic first.
Okay, can anybody hear?
How is the audio?
Yeah, Annemieke is coming over loud.
Okay,
clear.
You have greetings from Abu Dhabi.
Hello, Abu Dhabi.
That's all.
Awesome. Okay, Frank, you should really try out a new update for Lightroom CC Classic. Great new profiles. Yes, I heard about it and I installed it. Absolutely love it. The only thing is, I'm not really a Lightroom CC user. Don't tell anybody. I like it, don't get me wrong. I love it. I love Lightroom Mobile. But I have Lightroom CC Classic. By the way, what a mistake. They should have named Lightroom CC, Lightroom Connected, and Lightroom CC, just Lightroom CC. Don't call it Classic. Because a lot of people now think that Adobe actually stops promoting Lightroom, which of course, would be a very, very dumb move. So they don't. And you see that now. The updates are here. Lightroom CC Classic is just being updated. And all those guys that made panic like, oh, Adobe's going to leave Lightroom. Don't worry about it. Lightroom will be here to stay. And Lightroom CC, which I always call Lightroom Connected, that's the one that actually is the new one. And I really like it, but it's not my thing. My parents would be immediately in love with it because it's very easy to use. And in combination with Lightroom Mobile on your phone, it's absolutely stunning. But I actually use Lightroom Mobile on my phone, and I have this folder in Lightroom CC Classic where I actually get all my images in, and then I can rename it, because that's the thing that I don't like about the new CC. You can't rename your images. You can't do anything with them except retouch. And I want to do that other stuff. Okay, so Lightroom CC, the new version, the classic, is actually having new profiles. It's way faster. They finally put the dehaze filter somewhere else, so now you can actually find it without it being buried. And there's a lot more. My friend Scott Kelby actually has a new video on it. Make sure you check it out online. I shared it on my social media. And when Scott makes something about Lightroom, you just know it's freaking awesome. So make sure you check it out. Okay, are you ready for the live shoot? I would say yes, right? Why not? So let's switch over to the set first and show you what we set up, and I will explain that a little bit in depth. So here we have the setup, and one of the things that you will immediately notice that I use a little bit of a weird backdrop. It's very, very, well, how do you call it? It's a real Dutch backdrop. It's used many, many times, and it should be replaced, but we didn't. So there's a lot of wrinkles there and a lot of other stuff. When you zoom in, you can actually see it very clearly. And it's okay, but you know, it's a challenge in a moment to do Photoshop and show you very, very quickly how you can solve this. The setup is actually two strobes on the back with the white reflectors from Elingrom. And we have a beauty dish with a grid. I really, really love beauty dishes with grids because they're just freaking awesome, because you can literally steer the light. And a beauty dish, it makes everything more beautiful, right? Of course. So the setup is very simple. We use cross lighting on the backdrop, meaning that we will light the backdrop pure white. And pure white actually means that we have 255 in Lightroom, Capture One or whatever. And that also means that the model will be correctly lit. And I actually, at the end, we do a photo critique, and I have some really cool examples of where it can go wrong. So make sure you check out the end, or just stay watching, because it's gonna be a lot of fun today. Okay, let's switch back, and let me go to my place in the studio. First switch over camera, so Anouk doesn't have to do that, because we're still using an external switcher for that. There we go. Okay, Anouk, are you ready to take over from me?
Yes.
Awesome. We're going to start up picture in picture, so we have the desktop here, and you guys can see Capture One. There we go. And let me walk to my place. Are you ready, Rosa?
Yeah.
Okay. Rosa, please stand on the backdrop.
Yes.
Let me find a light meter. Okay, Rosa, can you move a little bit more forward? There we go. Now, the first thing we want to do, of course, is make sure that Rosa is lit correctly. Now, how do we light Rosa correctly? Very simple, by using the light meter. So I'm going to turn on this one. This is a D-Light 4 from Elingrom. You guys asked me to use something else than all the ELCs, because the ELCs are a little bit more expensive. And this actually proves that we can also do it with, well, very cheap cameras. Anouk, are you having me on the right camera now? Awesome. Just checking. Okay, first we're going to start out with just using the beauty dish. So I'm not going to do anything with the backdrop yet. Can you move a little bit forward? There we go. Okay, so it's straight on my model. So we're going to create a little bit of a beauty light, like a butterfly. 8.03, and 8.03 actually means F9. Why F9? Very simple, F8 and 3/10 of an f-stop. And your camera works in 3/10 of an f-stop, meaning F8, one click up, and that's F9. The light meter just works really, really fast with that. Okay, so let's grab our camera. And today, as always, I'm shooting with the Sony A7 R3. And we finally got, by the way, the grip. And that's something that I really like, because, well, I have big hands. And I want to make sure that I actually get my camera. Okay, can you look straight at me and just make your hair a little bit more flat? There we go. Okay, awesome. I'm going to focus on our eyes. And there we go. Now what you will see is that we have a, I think, beautiful gray backdrop with a nice vignetting. Now, how the heck did I do that vignetting? That's very simple. You always have to remember angle of lighting. So in other words, if your angle of lighting is like this, you will actually create it on the backdrop. So let me switch to the other camera by explaining that. So Nick, if you can get that camera on me. So if you now look in the back, you can actually see that my light is straight on my model. And because it's straight on the model, it actually means that it creates a narrow beam of light because of the grid, also on the backdrop. So you get this nice, beautiful vignetting. The only problem we now have is that I still see a little bit of the sides. So what can you do? You can, of course, ask your model to go more back. But if she goes more back, she's out of the light. And let's say that we have a model that we have to stay exactly there. Now, you always have to remember that your camera also has a wider angle of view or a narrower angle of view. In other words, if I shoot it on, let's say, 50 mil, I have an angle of view like this. If I shoot it on 70, I create a tighter angle of view. So let me switch over to the other camera again. And let's just zoom in a little bit more. And let me see if that camera still captures me. There we go. So by zooming in and using that 70 mil, I now actually don't see anything on the sides anymore, or at least a lot less. So that's cool. If I go in closer and I do 24, I actually will see my whole backdrop. And this is one of the mistakes that a lot of guys who start out with photography make. They zoom out too much and they see the backdrop. Zoom in and literally just zoom in and you create your backdrop that is a lot wider. There we go. Really like this. Now, another thing. You see me shooting on the display. And this is something that I've been doing more and more lately. Now, normally with photography, what do you do? You do, of course, this. So you put your camera in front of your face, focus on your model, and shoot. And this is awesome. Especially if you're an ugly photographer. That's why in the past, they actually had this big black cloth that you put over your head. Because then the model didn't see you. Just put some food in there and the photographer was fine. I'm just kidding, guys. Now, later on, when you saw the Hasselblads and, of course, the Mamiya RC67 Pro 2, one of the best cameras ever built, one of the things that stood them apart was actually they didn't have a viewfinder, but they had a waist level finder. Now, what is a waist level finder? It's actually you hold your camera like this and you look down, and then you have a waist level finder. So that means that it's on your waist. So actually, they shot it like this. One of the main advantages is that I can literally just look at my model, but also my peripheral vision, you know what I mean, right? Also works because now I can literally see everything from the corner of my eyes. But the coolest thing is I now actually have direct eye contact with my model. So I can focus on my model, even use eye focus, for example, on the Sony. Awesome. Just look at me straight. There we go. Okay, look straight into the lens. Nice. So I'm using eye focus on the Sony, so I know the Sony will actually find the eyes. Now, this doesn't work on all Sony lenses, but when it works, it's literally pure magic. You just press the OK button and it will find one of the eyes of the model, the one closest to the camera, and it will focus on that eye. So you don't have to think about it. I can just aim my camera, press the OK button, and then just use my shutter release. And I can literally just look at my model if her eyes are okay, if her pose is okay. And this works way better. Plus, I can look at my model. Hi.
Hi.
How are you? Awesome. Okay, so, but you didn't come here, of course, to show or to see a gray backdrop, right? You want to see that white background. Now, what is the most made mistakes with white backgrounds? People make them go nuclear. Now, what the heck do I mean with nuclear? Very simple. They make them go so white that it actually reflects back on my model. I'm going to show you very quickly how you set it up. If you want to make sure that you get it right, get one of our new videos. It's called the Essential Lighting Techniques. And in the Essential Lighting Techniques, I show you everything about how to set up the white background much more in depth. But now I'm going to just do it very fast. So the best way to set up that white background is actually with a reflective meter reading. So I'm going to grip my light meter. And I'm going to stand in the place where I normally would stand. So that's here. I'm going to go into reflective metering. So they actually call it spot here. And the thing is, I now know that this one is f8.3. So that means f9. Let's go for f8. Now, one of the things that I explained in Mastering the Model Shoot and in all the videos is that, especially the older videos, let's say 5-6 years ago, if you open up from f8.3, 2.5 stops, in theory, the backdrop would be pure white for the very simple reason you have 18% gray, one stop extra is 36, one stop extra is 72, and one stop extra is 144. 144 is way over white, so let's go to 100, that's about 2.5 steps. There's one very, very big problem. Nowadays, modern sensors have a so-called shoulder. So they're not really linear anymore. There's like a little bit of a bump on the top. So that means that we need a lot more. I know for the Sony cameras, I need about 4 stops extra. So that means if I want to get my model the perfect white backdrop, I have to go 4 stops over my main lighting. So just for calculation-wise, let's call this F8. So 4 stops extra from F8 is actually 11, 16, 22, 32. So I have to go to F32, reflective on the backdrop. Don't ever do this incident. Now what is incident? Incident is using that little dome, hold it in front of your subject, and you have the correct exposure. If you want to shoot a white backdrop incident, it's very simple. 8.3, make sure that the backdrop is 8.3. The only problem is it a really white backdrop? You never know. Maybe it's Phoenician white or Greek white or whatever white. Turkish white?
Turkish white.
Greek white? Moonlight white? Moonlight white? Dark night white? Whatever. It can be whatever. So with reflective, you actually take out that equation. You just aim it at something and it will give you the value for 18% gray. Being it black, white, it doesn't matter. 18% gray. So from there I can build. Okay, so let's turn on the strobes. We're going to start with this one. And then we're going to do this one. Now, normally you can, of course, build it up by using it one by one. But the main thing is, as long as the backdrop is 100% white, I'm fine. So we're just going to put them both on. And we'll just see what happens. There we go. Now, it's incredibly important that I do this from the angle where I'm shooting on. Because if I don't do it, and I aim, for example, like this, the bottom will be correctly lit and the top won't. So I'm shooting from a lower angle, so that would be around here. Now let's just meter this. 22.5, 22.8, 22.7, 22.4, 22.5. So that one should actually go up 5/10 plus 3, of course. There we go. And the other one should go up around 6 because I have to go to f8.3. There we go. Let's do the whole metering again. 32.4. That's pretty close. 32.3. That's perfect. 32.7. A little bit over, but that's okay. And 32.5. So I should have a nice, white, clean backdrop. Because again, this was 8.3. If this was 8.0, I would have ended up with F32. Okay. So, Rose, are you ready for your white backdrop?
I'm ready.
Are you ready? Nice. Okay. Oh, one thing. Almost forgot. If the backdrop gets a lot of light, what happens to the front, you think? Yes, the front will actually also get a little bit more light because it reflects back. Now, I'm wearing dark clothing. Now, if I would be wearing white, a lot of light would be reflecting back. But because I'm wearing darker clothing, not a lot of light will reflect back. But watch this. You remember it was 8.3, right? Okay. Now, imagine shooting it right now. You would get a lot of different exposures because watch what happens. So I'm aiming towards my light source. And there we go. So I'm about 1/10 off. That's actually pretty good. Didn't expect that one. So that's pretty good. But always do that remetering because sometimes we actually end up with a lot more, depending also on the studio. I think now because, well, we're in our own studio, we don't have a lot of white walls, but, well, light can reflect. Okay. So there we go. Awesome. And now we have the perfect white backdrop. Nice. Okay, eyes straight ahead. There we go. Awesome. Rosa, this is really cool. Eyes a little bit more up towards the light. There we go. Can you turn around very violently and twist your hair around? Are you ready? One, two, go. And one more. One, two, go. Oh, I always love these shots. Final one. One, two, go. Wait for my count. One, two, go. Nice. Okay, so what can we do more with a white backdrop? Let's first just turn this one off. Let's see if we can create a silhouette. And I'm already going to tell you the first shot, no way. So let's try this. There we go. Now what you see is that there's still a lot of light on my model. So it's not really the perfect, well, silhouette. So what should you do? Well, first of all, the front should be completely black. Now there's something called negative lighting. So that means that actually when you use something black, it actually reflects back black, meaning that, well, it takes away lighting. We're not going to do that now. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to change my lighting setup just slightly to make sure that the front will be a little bit darker. So how do you do that? Very simple. You just close down. So you go to, for example, F16. Okay. Zoom in. Now what you see is that the backdrop actually gets darker. That's a problem. But the front, well, it's also darker. And that's because you changed that exposure. So how do you do it to make it completely dark? I'm not going to show you now, but I'm just going to explain it to you. What you have to do is push your model all the way forward, place some black stuff around her, and then she will be completely dark. So why did I show this in between? Well, dark is nice. Watch this. So we're going to do something else. I'm going to go to F9 again. I'm going to do something a little bit differently. I'm going to take out my light meter. And I'm going to meter straight in front of my model's face. So, in the past, this was F8.3. Now, it's 2.86. What does it mean? 2.86, that's 2.8 and 2 clicks up. So, let me just grab the camera. Go to 2.8. Okay, there we go. And if you can't calculate that, you don't know it's 3.5, just do it like this. 2.8, one click up 3.2, one click up 3.5. Now what I did is I metered incident on the face of my model, meaning that if I hold my meter in front of the subject I want correctly lit, that will actually give me that value, meaning that actually my backdrop is now 2.86, so it's reflecting back a lot of light. Watch this. This is a really cool effect. Now you get those really nice, almost like encapsulated by the light looks. Nice. Okay, can you do the twist again? Okay, are you ready?
Yeah.
One, two, go. And one more. Oh, that's also nice. Okay, one, two, go. And the final one. One, two, go. Awesome. So we go from a normally lit setup with my main light on 8.3, so F9, to 2.86, 3.5, where you get a completely different look from that same backdrop. The cool thing is you only have to set it up once. And if you remember 3.5 for this effect, you turn that one on and you go back to F9, you can literally just stun your customer by just showing him, hey, you know what? We have a gray backdrop, we have a white backdrop, and we have this beautiful wraparound light, all in one setup, by just moving around your strobes, sorry, without moving around your strobes and just turning it on and off. But let's see how this looks in Photoshop, because in Photoshop, of course, we have to do that retouching. And in the meantime, they're going to set up something else, because the next shot is going to be high contrast. It's going to be very, very nice. And it's going to be against a Baroque backdrop. So let me go back to the computer, and we're going to do some funky stuff in Photoshop. Okay, and let me first see if there are any questions. So I'm going to switch cameras again. Let me see. One, two. I'm going to go to the right camera for now. Let me switch back to full. Okay, first questions. Hey Frank, when using a beauty dish, does your sitter have to have flawless skin, or can it be used with people with less than perfect flesh tone, with less than perfect skin, I think you mean. It's very simple. The better the skin of your model, the better the end result will be. It's that simple. The beauty dish itself, if you use it straight on, it will give you nicer, pleasinger effects than if you use the beauty dish under an angle. Because under an angle, remember this, pores in the skin are always determined by shadows and highlights, right? Otherwise we can't see any depth. So if you have a model that has a bad skin, often we mean not by bad skin, we mean bad skin, but we mean that she has a lot of pores or a little bit of dimples. If you light it under a straight angle, all those dimples and all those pores will be blown away by the lighting. If you light it under an extreme angle, everything will just show up and you get a lot of shadows. It will just look very nasty, so don't do that. So with the beauty dish or strip light or softbox, it doesn't matter. If your model has poor skin, just try to avoid that high contrast lighting, or just know that you can Photoshop the heck out of it. And let me see. Aren't you shooting just portraits now? And I find the fashion that you also shoot half body or full body shots. Aren't you doing that? Yes, in fashion, we often do both. So I wanted to start out by just showing that wide backdrop. What we're going to do in the next set is actually we're going to shoot a full body with Rosa. And what they have to do, by the way, is you have to remove the white and make sure that the white lambrisering is also there, the white bar. So for the next set, without any doubt, we're going to do some high-end fashion. And we're actually going to also bring in a prop in the form of a small chair. So don't worry, we're not done yet. It's a two-hour broadcast and we're only 47 minutes in. Okay, greetings from Knust, Ghana. Hello, Knust, Ghana. I don't know where it lies, but sounds far away. Interesting. Okay, let's go to our images. Okay, let me see where my mouse is at the moment. There we go. Okay, so the first thing I always do is actually select my images. That helps a lot because then I know what I actually want to retouch. Now, normally, of course, you shoot a color checker, right? Because the color checker is one of the most important shots, but I already have everything in the computer. That doesn't mean that you can get away without shooting a color checker, guys. But Capture One doesn't support the color checker inboard, so I just use a separate profile I created with a color checker, and that's the one that I use in everything. Now, when you shoot with Lightroom or Photoshop or whatever, make sure that before every shoot you use that X-Rite color checker for the very simple reason you can get your colors correct. Now, this is just a broadcast. It's just something for the internet. So if the color isn't that correct, it's okay. But make sure if you do a proper job, use those color checkers because they're really important. Somebody says, I'm looking forward to Saturday. Yes, that's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be classical lighting. We still have one seat left. So if you are watching this and you wanna go to classical lighting where we do all the stuff like George Harrell, Helmut Newton, Effedon, Harcourt, make sure you subscribe, you mail me. Let me see, Bert Janssen was a bit late, but hi Frank and team. Hey Bert, how are you? Awesome. Okay, so I'm first going to do my selection. Now, I'm very, very strict with what I delete. So I'm actually going to delete the images that I don't like. Now, I really like this one, so let me give that 5 stars. And I'm giving everything 5 stars that I like. I'm only going to select one in a moment. Ooh, that's a blackmail shot, as we call it. Now, what's a blackmail shot? It's a really bad shot you take of your model, and then when she's not nice to you, you can always show that shot and go like, eh. To her, of course, don't put it online. Okay, don't like the hairs here, so those shots we won't use. Okay, nice. Okay, here we have the first white. Now, what I want to show you with that white backdrop is one of the things that you always see in white backdrops is actually that the hairs are really just destroyed by all that lighting coming back. Now, what I did in this case is actually set up something that you guys can do. If we do this normally, we would place the model at least 2 meters more forward, meaning that silhouette will actually work way better. The model was now way too close to the backdrop for the silhouette, but watch this. So if she moved more forward, the hairs would be even better. But do you see here that even the smallest hairs still show up? So there's nothing blown out. It's just all the detail is still there. Look at that. And that's because we actually lit the backdrop 100% correct. And when you light something 100% correct, it doesn't become nuclear. It doesn't blow back all that lighting. So in other words, you have beautiful detail in hairs. Sometimes it actually gives you way too much detail. Oh, really like this one. So go to 5. Okay, love this one. Okay, this was one with the dark. Now you see that actually when we change this, whatever you do, you can't make it 100% black. And that's because the model is too close to the backdrop. Pull it two meters forward and you will have a beautiful, beautiful dark model. Now, what you can do, of course, is add just a little bit of contrast and just use your curves and just lock your top and just pull it down here. Now, pull your top a little bit higher. There you go. And there you have your silhouette, but make sure that you don't blow that out. Now take away your saturation. And there you have your silhouette. So you can still do it if your model is too close to the front, but better is just to pull it forward like 2 meters, like I said before, and you don't have to do all this stuff in Lightroom or Capture One. By the way, Lightroom and Capture One, don't worry, because I'm using Capture One. Lightroom does exactly the same stuff. I just like tethering in Capture One a lot better. Plus, I really think that the raw conversion in Capture One is better than Lightroom. But I absolutely love Lightroom. I couldn't live without it. Okay, so I really like this wraparound effect, for example, here. So give that 5 stars. Oh, so I like this one. There's something really, I don't know, 70s about it. Okay, and the movement. It's okay. Let me give that one also 5 stars. Okay, very quickly. We have done everything on rating. Now, I'm always going to go through again. So when I look at the difference, I really don't like this shot anymore. I like this one way better. Look at those intense eyes. I don't like that one. It's a little bit too flat. Love this one. Love this one. Really nice. Actually like that one better. So do it 0. And I love this one. Okay. So, how long will it take me to edit these shots? Actually, pretty, pretty fast. So, I'm going to switch over to full screen, and I'm going to show you exactly what we're going to do with retouching. So, I'm going to go to desktop. I'm going to find my pen somewhere. There it is. Okay, first things first. We have to get it into Photoshop. So, to Photoshop. And what I do is a TIFF. Ooh, should be 16 bits. Uncompressed. Always make sure that you do Adobe RGB or Pro Photo RGB, because otherwise Photoshop will crash. And open with Adobe Photoshop. I don't know why it doesn't save that. Let's just save this as Frank to Photoshop. Okay. So now I can actually delete this one. Okay. Oh, my mistake. Adobe RGB. And open with Photoshop. Okay. Let's start up. And let's hope that everything works. Okay. Starting up Photoshop. Anyway, do we have any questions in between on Facebook?
Nope.
Okay. It's quiet. Okay, fit on screen. Now, the first thing, of course, I want to do is make sure that that backdrop is a little bit softer. So let's create a duplicate layer. Let's take the Harry Potter stick and let's put it on a low tolerance and just select it. And you can do this really, really rough. So you don't need to do it very nice. And it's not important that you miss some hairs. It's just the general idea you have to select. Do make sure that you absolutely don't include anything of your model. So no skin tones. Nothing. If you miss a little bit, like here on the corners, that's no problem at all, but don't include any skin tones or model clothing or whatever. Don't. Okay, so what we do now is select, and we're gonna do a feather, just very slightly, let's say 4 pixels. Select inverse, and now we do cut, and there we go. So now we have lost our model. There we go. Now go to filter. Go to blur, go to Gaussian blur, and just blur the heck out of it. Okay. Now you immediately see the problem. especially on gray seamless, you can see this really good. So if I zoom in, you can see that we have a lot of these bendings. I hope that shows up on Photoshop, but it's a really, really messy, really messy situation at the moment. We have a lot of those bending areas. How do you solve this? Of course, you can clone, but it never works. So what you can do is filter, go to noise, and you do the opposite of blur, and that's actually add noise. I don't overdo it. Go to Gaussian, monochromatic, and just add 0.4. That's usually more than enough. Oh, 0.4. There we go. And as you can see, before and after, all that nasty stuff is gone. Haha, we loved it. Okay, and now we do edit, paste into place, and now my model is back. And now you see those nasty corners here. Do you see that? I will explain in a second what went wrong. So let's just remove this. Let's remove that. Okay, what did I do wrong? As you can see, there's a lot of gradients in this area here. So what I should have done, and this is something that I really want to stress to you guys, that's why I do it this way, is select. And, oh, one moment. Select and do it again. So I'm doing the same rough selection. And the reason I'm doing this, I made a video about this a while ago, and a lot of people emailed me like, Frank, it looks like it's gonna work, but it doesn't. What did I do wrong? And actually, what I did wrong is the following step. Select, modify, feather, 4 pixels, select, inverse. Now, up until now, I'm doing everything exactly the same. Cut. Now we're gonna change something. Now we're going to do filter, blur, and instead of just blurring the heck out of it, I'm just going to put it on 0, and I'm just going to gradually build up the effect of my blur until I see that my backdrop actually is smoother. Now, it doesn't have to be 100% smooth. It's just the point where you start seeing that the hairs start to disappear. There we go. And also all the wrinkles are a little bit less. Now, don't make it too clean. There we go. Do the same thing again. Filter, noise. Add noise, there we go, edit, paste into place, and now you will see that the effect is much better, because now you don't see those nasty areas where you go like, this is something where somebody cloned something. So that's better. Layer, flatten image. Okay, again, if you do see some weird stuff, it's probably compression from YouTube. But if we zoom in, you can see that it's now on my screen exactly seamless. Well, in the previous version, we had a very light area here and a very dark area here, which didn't make any sense. Okay, second of all, never zoom in like this when your model is close. Because those digital cameras really don't hide anything. Okay, so what I'm going to do is first I'm going to take out the main problems. And you can, of course, do that with your healing brush, as you can see here. But that's a lot of work. So there's a much simpler and much faster way. Go to your quick mask, take your brush, make sure that the brush is big enough, and paint over everything that you want gone. So if your mother-in-law is in the picture, paint over. No, I'm just kidding. Am I? Okay. So let's take that one out. Let's do this and this and this and this. There we go. Maybe here, here, here. Okay. Now, put on your mask. There we go. And now just press delete. And now you see content aware, color adaption, mode normal, 100%. Press OK. And this works way faster than using your clone tool or your healing brush. Is it perfect? No. Sometimes you have to do it over. Sometimes you have to use your clone tool or your healing brush again. But it's just a way, way faster way of working. Okay, eyes have to be opened up just a little bit. So use your dodge tool and just go through the eyes. There we go. And I only do the irises because that looks nicer. Okay, for skin retouching, I'm very, very simple. I'm just doing one filter, image normal portraiture. You can also use Topaz Labs. And that one is also cool, but this one works in batch, so it's a little bit better. I always have it on nuclear, so that means that all detail is destroyed. I'm going to show you in a minute why. Press OK. Now, of course, I don't want all the detail to be destroyed, but on some areas I do, and on some areas I don't. And I found out that it's better to just put it on nuclear, and then just paint the effect in. So let's do a layer mask, a hide all. There we go. I got a remark here. Frank, you're too funny. Okay, I will try to be a little bit more serious. Frank, what's the exact difference in a paid... Oh, let me switch to my camera. That's much more nicer that I talk to you guys. Sorry, sometimes I forget to switch cameras. Frank, what's the exact difference in a paid fashion shoot and a TFP-based fashion shoot? Do you use more or different lighting or more setups? For me, there's absolutely no difference between a paid gig and a TFP gig. As soon as you make differences between those gigs, it actually means that you're not working as hard as you should. So in other words, if it's a paying gig, I use 5 strobes and I do my utmost best in retouching. If I do a TFP, I just do it with 1 strobe. I think that's wrong. I think in both situations, you should do your utmost best. You should make sure that your client is as satisfied as possible, even for the TFPs. Because with TFP, you can actually just do the stuff that you want to do and make great shots. And that will actually land you the paying gigs. Now, if you're doing a paying gig, the only thing that I do is I have a little bit more eye for what my client wants. So if my client tells me like, Frank, I really like the high contrast looks, and I'm going like, I'm more into a flat lighting mood, which I never am, I will actually still use that high contrast lighting. I'll just squeeze in 1 or 2 shots with flat lighting. If it's a TFP shot and I'm into this flat lighting mood, and my client wants high contrast, I will do it the other way around. I will mostly shoot it in what I want, and I will just squeeze some images in for her or him in what she or he wants. And with retouching, I do exactly the same for a paid client or for TFP. I just want to deliver my images the best way possible. There's no difference between paid or TFP. Sometimes even with TFP, I actually do a little bit more work for the very simple reason that's my portfolio stuff. Let me see. What do you do when the skin goes somewhat gray in the shadows? I don't know what you mean by that, but if the skin goes somewhat gray in the shadows, that's often a problem with rendering or with lighting. And if that happens, it actually means that there's no light hitting your model there. So what I would probably do is just add a little bit of kicker with strobes or a reflector, for example, silver reflector. Just add it up. Okay, so let's continue here. So now I have my layer mask, and the first thing I do is go to 100% and just put my brush down to, let's say, 63%, and just take out some of the unevenness of the skin. And the cool thing is, because it's on nuclear, it actually adds up when I lift up my brush and do it again. And of course you can use pressure sensitivity, but in this case I will just use it by taking out the pen and putting it back again. Yes, Anouk. I forgot to switch the monitor. That's dumb. There we go. Okay, so we'll do that again. Let me go back. Okay. So I have my brush on 62%. And I will just paint the effect in. As you can see here, it's very, very subtle, actually, compared to the 100%. So I'm never going to use this on 100%. I'm just going to let it build up. Again, you can use pressure sensitivity, but I just like it like this. And the areas where I do want it more, I just lift up my pen and put it down again. And that way you have a very, very precise way of retouching. It's literally awesome. I've been using this now for a few months. And it's way better than what I did in the past. In the past, I would just get it 100% right in Image Normal Portraiture. I would then actually do it on my model. And then on some areas, I needed a little bit more, so I run the filter twice. And at one point, I just realized, like, this is a lot of work for absolutely nothing. So let's just do it like this, and it worked out fine. Okay, see before and after. Now, it looks like I took away way too much. Now watch this, if you go to 100%, you will. That's why you should always judge on 100%. You see that it's actually pretty good. Okay, let's just take down the effect a little bit. There we go. So I still want my model to look normal and natural. I don't want it to be appearing like a Barbie. So this is actually what I want. Okay, layer, flatten image. And the only thing I now have to do is tint my image. And for tinting, we're actually going to use Skylum Luminar. First, let's save. Because we had a big update on Luminar, which I didn't run yet. So let's see what happens. By the way, you can now get my preset pack for Luminar. I'll show you very quickly where you can find those presets. In the meantime, Luminar is starting on a different monitor.
Talking about Luminar, Frank, there will be an update soon.
Yeah, no, but we can't tell anybody about it yet. But trust me, it's going to be awesome. April 12th? Oh, that's the same time that my new phone will come in a week. So I can retouch all my phone images in Luminar. Awesome. Okay, let's go to custom. And again, these presets you can now order online on my website. And don't spend too much money on presets, by the way. We only charge like 10 euros for a preset pack. Some people will charge you 200. It's not worth it, guys, because actually they're just presets. So don't spend too much money on it. But 10 euros, that's fine. That's why we actually choose that price. Okay, as you can see, I'm looking for a certain look. And I sometimes call this clickety-click until I see what I like. And it's actually pretty close to the truth. Because I never know what I'm really liking until I see it. And I think for this one, I actually have to keep it a little bit more simple. So go to my Riella look. That's too reddish. That's too much. By the way, I always make a preset standard. So this is with everything on zero. There we go. I really like this. No. It's not something that I like until so far. My model is with me and she's also looking like, no, don't like that one. That's nice. That gives me a little bit more of a vintage look. Okay. I, of course, don't want everything in there. So just go down and do the filters amount on zero. And then just very slightly build it up. There we go. I have to judge it on the BenQ monitor, guys. One moment. Because I love the Wacom, but it's not a really color accurate monitor. Yeah, that's awesome. That's really nice. Okay, press OK. And apply. There we go. Okay, let me see if you have any questions in between. Frank, you have to change screen again. No, I'm on the right screen now. Whoa, what did you do just there? Smoothing out the skin, that was fast. Okay, what I did, Matt, was actually use a plugin called, not Alien Skin Exposure, still love that one, by the way. But I used a plugin that actually called Imagenomic Portraiture. Now, I will never tell you guys to spend money on stuff that you don't need. Let me get that straight. Over the years, I hope I build a reputation that if I tell you guys, buy this, run out to the stores and buy this freaking piece of software or this amazing camera, please trust me, it's something that I use myself and that I really love. I'm not for sale. I will never tell you guys, get this if I don't use it myself. Over the years, Imagenomic Portraiture has without any doubt been my absolute favorite plugin. The funny thing is, it's the only company we don't work with together. So we work with Luminar, Skylum. We work with Alien Skin. We work very close to Topaz. We work with Adobe. We work with DxO, X-Rite. We work with all these companies that I use their plugins from. Imagenomic Portraiture, I don't even think they know that I exist. But it's an amazing plugin for skin. So make sure you get it. And it's just very, very cool. And it's expensive. It's like, I believe 199 euros in a week, something in that area. So it's expensive, but you can run it in batch, meaning you can write an action in Photoshop and it will literally just do the same action over and over again. And it's just, it's awesome. It's very, very good. So make sure you check it. Yes, anyway, we have a question.
I have another birthday boy watching and he's asking, have you seen the new creative color toning in Lightroom?
I did install Lightroom. I didn't see the creative coloring. I did see the new profiles, which I absolutely like. If you mean those, yes, they are really interesting. And I want to see what happens when we actually use the color checker in combination with. I don't know if that will work fine, but we'll see. But overall, I think Adobe really, really did a good job on their new update. And I really see that it's faster. And that's something that I really like to see in Adobe. By the way, talking about updates, check out what they did with Premiere or what's coming with Premiere. Freaking awesome. I really like that. We edit the vlog daily. Not daily, of course. We only do it when it's something interesting going on. So we do it during workshops or travel. But when we do it daily when we travel. And they now have this new feature where you actually do taller cone correction over the whole batch. So that means you only correct one scene and it will actually figure out the rest of the scenes. Really looking forward to using that. I know that in the past, like Resolve had something like that and Apple's Final Cut Pro had something like this, but this is for Premiere absolutely amazing. So I'm really looking forward to that. Adobe is doing great, great work at the moment with updating their suite. Okay, now this one took a little bit of time and I don't want to do that again. So I'm going to show you how to retouch the other ones really fast. So let's switch back to my desktop. There we go. And let's just take the other one. So let's go to Capture One, the white backdrop. Okay, now because I already set up everything, the only thing I have to do is actually go into Photoshop. Ah, thank you, Michael. Michael actually told me here, your Lumina preset kit is absolutely awesome. I can deeply recommend it. Great value for the money. I'm using it since several weeks. Okay, just for fun. Presets. You can buy here. And Michael says it's great. And Michael is a very serious photographer. Has some really cool shots that I'm going to show you at the end. So trust Michael and get my presets. You're going to love him. And otherwise, Michael's address is... Oh, we have some static and interference. I'm so sorry. Okay, so let's go here. View, fit on screen. Okay, now because I already did this, the only thing I have to do is actually go into, yes, Portrait Smooth, press play. What it will now do is create a duplicate layer, will run image number portraiture on the previous setting, create a layer mask hole. The only thing I now have to do is get my brush, put it on 63% where it already is. This is the cool thing about doing workflows. I talk to people about this a lot and they say, well, we have to change everything over again. How can you retouch that fast? It's very simple. I always retouch in batches. So that means that if I do something, I will leave everything set up. So the next image that comes in can use exactly the same settings and I'm done. So layer flatten image, view 100%. So I'm going to take the Dutch tool, going to open up our eyes just a little bit in the irises. There we go. Okay, cool. Fit on screen. And I don't even want to tint this image. I really like it. So let's do that without using any fancy software. Let's go into Image Adjustments. Let's go into Curves. And let's go into the RGB. So let's just take away a little bit of the shadows, the reds, and add a little bit to the highlights. There we go. Go into the blues. Now add a little bit of blue to the shadow areas. And take away a little bit of the blues, or add, let me see what is nicer, there we go. Go back to the reds and then just finish it off. There we go. Now if you look before and after, you can see that actually also with curves you can create some pretty cool and nifty effects. I should have saved that one. Okay, file close. So we're done with this shot. As you can see now, the speed actually picks up because now the next one is actually this one. Oh, this one will be black and white because I love black and white and motion. So let's go here. The only problem is, of course, we miss something on this side. How do we solve that? Well, take your lasso tool. I'm sorry I'm going so fast, guys, but this is how we retouch. Go here, do the lasso tool, and just press delete. And Content Aware Fill will do the rest. Hey Frank, how do we do this if we don't have that beautiful white backdrop? Okay, I'm going to show you another trick. And this one is actually pretty nifty too. Take your marquee tool, zoom out, Control minus or Command minus, depending on PC or Mac. And just select this as close as possible to your model. There we go. Just move it a little bit. There we go. Go to Edit, Transform and Scale. And there we go. So you do exactly the same thing and you're done. Apply. Okay. Deselect. Now you know the drill. Portrait smooth. So you run the filter. Now there's one thing with this shot, because there's a lot of hair in front of her face. I don't want it to be too aggressive. So first the neck area and chest, we're going to do pretty aggressive. And then we're going to zoom in. And you see that because I've shot it with the D-lights, this is something that we always talk about in workshops. The D-lights are not really good at freezing action. So there will always be a little bit of a blur. Now, I have to be honest, this one is blurred a lot. So this was probably a focus error on my part. But hey, that doesn't matter. Because I always make the joke, and now you guys can actually see that it's the God honest truth. If you really mess up a shot, but you still like it, what do you do? I hear a lot of people now going like, make it black and white, add contrast and noise and instant art. I know you did it. Go to Luminar again and go to the black and whites. Let me see. Why is your logo on the right side of the screen? Okay, that's very simple. I can take that logo out. But we actually brand our broadcasts. See? So it's literally something that we brand with. Makes it a little. It makes it look a little bit more professional, I think, or not? It's there. Okay. Okay. I'm now in Luminar, so let's take Luminar back to the original monitor. Oops. There we go. Okay. Go to categories. Go to custom. And go to the black and whites. And just go through them. Until I see one that I like. I think I like it really, really harsh in this shot. So I'd probably go for my black and white stark. There we go. I really like this. And now you can actually see what all my presets do on the backdrop. I also really like this one. But because it's a little bit out of focus, I'm not going to use this one. It's a shame, by the way. Oh, let me try the gothic. No, that's too much. So let's go to this one. And now because I actually messed up my focus, what I'm going to do, and normally that hardly ever happens. Now, some people make the joke that if they see a black and white shot of me, hey, he missed his focus. I actually like making it black and white, and that doesn't always mean I miss my focus. But on average, if I miss my focus, it will be black and white afterwards. Okay, so I don't have any noise in here. And the cool thing about Luminar is actually, if you don't have any noise in your plugin, you would have to use another plugin. Not with Luminar, you just go to Add Filters. And you go to, for example, creative. And for example, it's nothing. Oh, there we go, grain. Now, if you don't know what it does, just press the I from info. And there we go, grain emulates the structure of analog film stock. Yeah, sure. Introducing a random stylized grain into your image. Oh, I'm getting hungry already. Keep in mind that grain and photo noise are different things. That's true. Use grain to give your color and black and white images a cool analog feel. Okay. Sounds cool. So go to grain. Okay, there we go. Awesome. There we go. And let's change the roughness. Nice. Okay, and do it before and after. Now you see that I only switch between color and black and white, but it already looks nicer with a little bit of grain. Take it with a salt of grain. Oh, whatever. And you can also see what grain itself does by just clicking on the eye. And you see that it really makes a difference between an out-of-focus mess and, well, a grainy mess. But anyway, it looks better. So press apply. And there we go. Let me see. Which should I make a cup for, Bert? The one about the black and white? Somebody says you have to make a drinking cup of that expression and I will buy one.
A mug.
A mug. Oh, can you get my mugs, Anouk? That I will show the guys that we actually have some mugs. Or XLT t-shirts or a little thing for on the wall. Come on, guys. Be serious. I'm a serious guy. I'm trying to... No, I'm not. Okay. File close. Okay, there we go. Yes. Okay, next one. I'm going to go a little bit faster now. This one is cool. Go into Photoshop. And in between, I want to show you guys something. Because Bert, of course, says you make a mug out of that. We actually do. We have the Why Fake It When You Can Create It mugs. You can give it to your wife or your parents or whatever. And they will never fake it again. And we, of course, have learning with Frank over there. Rosa's now looking at me like, what? There we go, go back to the desktop. Okay. Phew, fit on screen. Again, portrait smooth. You see that there's a certain way of working and it's really fast and structured. And that's what you really should do, guys. If you want to do only retouching and never see your family, make sure that you do every shot separately.
But if you also want to do some stuff next to photography and retouching, make sure that you figure out what works for you. Okay, flatten image. Let's see if we can close in on the eyes and maybe make it pop a little bit, but not too much. You see what happens when we use that lens flare from the back? This is just evil. Ooh, make it red and it's really evil. So drop down the exposure to 10 and just open it up a little bit. Don't overdo this. There we go.
Much better.
Maybe a little bit more. Okay, cool. Okay, for the look, go into Skylum. And this one I'm going to do with that blue backdrop. As I really like that. Okay. And that one was close to the black and whites. I wish they would make it that you end up with your last setting. Let me give them an email about that one. Also like this one, but I want more fashion-y. This is also cool, a little bit of old glamour. Okay, there we go, color change. That's the one that I like. Ooh, that's nice. Okay, go all the way to the bottom. And just take the filter out a little bit. And just edit. Now the thing is, I don't like the reds in this one. I think the reds are a little bit over the top. So let's just put it on 100%. And the cool thing about this program is actually that you can also use here, your HSL, Hue Saturation Luminance. And what I can just do is the reds, just pull down the saturation. There we go. And maybe add a little bit of luminance to those reds to make the skin just a little bit more pop. Here you see when I have the luminance all the way to the bottom. And there we go. Really like this. Awesome. Okay. And press apply. So this is what I mean. You can always change your look by just changing it in your plugins. So those presets are just starting points, guys. Oh, we got a lot of questions in. Greetings from Argentina. I do not understand English, but even so, I have a good guide. I don't speak Argentina, so don't worry. Let me see. Antonio, Amaya, for me it's very fast too. My English is bad. Don't worry, Monique. Saturday I will do everything in Dutch. Oh, there we have one that I really need my camera. Because now I have to do something that I hate. I know we can have a little bit more of a drink. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Trevor. Do you prefer Skylum over Alien Skin? How many kids do you have? If you have two kids, don't ask the daddy which kid he likes most. Because he will never tell you the truth, right? You always like one kid more. You know you do. And I also like one kid more. So sometimes I like Skylum more, like Luminar. Sometimes I like Alien Skin more. And it's actually pretty simple to explain. If I want a real film look, so I want it subtle, film look. I want extra lighting effects. I want a little bit of structure. And I just want a freaking cool, awesome image that is close to the original. I go into Alien Skin Exposure without any doubt. Now, if I want to change the look of the image completely, I can also do that in Alien Skin Exposure. But the cool thing about Luminar is actually that we can just drag in modules. The weak point of Luminar, I feel, and I talked to them about it, and maybe they're going to change something in the future, is if you look at Alien Skin Exposure, it's awesome in creating film looks. Like, for example, if you want Velvia or Portra or whatever, it's just in there and it works. If you look at Luminar, they have this cross-processing thing and photo filters, but somehow I always end up with something that's, it's okay. But I still feel the need, for example, sometimes to just run Alien Skin Exposure for the real tinting. So it's a mixed bag of beans. I really like Luminar for all those plugins you can put together and create your own plugin. And I really like Alien Skin Exposure just for the look. So it's two children. I like them both. But sometimes one is a little bit more annoying than the other one. And Anouk is laughing and she goes like, you only have one son. I know. Okay, let's just save this one. Layer, flatten image. Oh, it's already done. And close. Okay, final one. And then we're going to do a next shoot. I hope you guys are still having fun. This one. Okay, this one is a little bit blown out. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to pull back my highlights. Do you see that? Oh, so much dynamic range in those Sony cameras. Don't we just love them? And if you say, hey, I like it in the shirt, but not in the hairs, you can in Capture One, of course, always go into your layers. Believe it or not, I don't know where my layers are. Okay, normally you can also go into your adjustment brush and layers. Ah, there we go. So I can actually just paint it in and just change, for example, my highlights on that area. There we go. Okay, go into, sorry guys, and just replaced it somewhere. Hey, stuff happens. Okay, so now we have to fill that gap again. Fit on screen, and there's a little bit of hair there, so that's a shame. But we just do it with the marquee tool for now. There we go. And just let Content Aware Fill do his magic. And this one is also going to be black and white. Okay, select, deselect. And I'll show you now with alien skin, by the way. So I'll show you the difference. Oh, a lot of remarks. Okay, let me first switch cameras, because there's... Okay. Good, I only have one kit. Okay, Trevor. let me see. Do you ever use actions for edits? You use often skin retouch. Yes, everything I do is in actions. So that means that I will actually literally just write actions for skin smoothing, for red channels, for blue channels, whatever. It just saves a lot of time. Let me see. Frank, can you tell us who is your favorite movie director and cinematographer, DP, and why? I'm not really into movie directors. I'm more into movies. And I think that when you look at what I do, and what I like, it's pretty obvious, right? We like Batman and superheroes. And in all honesty, the Marvel movies are cool to watch, but I really like what they're doing with DC at the moment. And I know DC is getting a lot of bad rep for the very simple reason they're too dark, there's no humor, but hey, wake up. That's how the comics of DC are. So I really like what they did with Batman vs. Superman. I liked Suicide Squad. I liked, well, Justice League, okay. Now, if you go outside that area, I'm actually not that interested in Hollywood at the moment. Just a quick example. Yesterday, we saw a Dutch movie, a police movie, and it's very realistic. And that's the same with Scandinavian movies, like Norwegian or Finland, or I don't know if that's really Scandinavian, but that area. And they create the most amazing crime movies and comedies and whatever. I think over the years, I'm a real movie fan. I love movies. We have Netflix and we Netflix the heck out of our Netflix account when we have time. And there's one rule, by the way, in House Dorhoff, and that's every day we watch at least two episodes of a show or we watch a movie. That's the only rule. Everything else goes and is work. But we have to do that. And I think over the years, I just grew very, very tired of Hollywood. It's all bombastic. It's all over the top nice. The directors are more explosions, more car chases. And at one point, it just starts to get ridiculous, coming from a guy who likes Batman. Right. So when you look at the Scandinavian movies, they're very, very real. They're down. They're down in color. They're very, very realistically filmed. The outcome is very realistically, like one of the main characters can die, or he has to rescue his son and his wife. And in an American movie, well, they both are saved in the last second, and you literally see a clock going down like zero, and it's save the day and hero music and whatever. In the Scandinavian movies, I found that really a few times. He was just 2 seconds too late, and his son died. It's terrible, I know. But it's how real life works, guys. Wake up. It's real life. And that's what I really like about those movies. You never know what's going to happen. It's like Game of Thrones. At one point, you can have your favorite characters all in one room and they're all going to die. And then you wonder, like, where the heck are they going to go in the next episode? But they still find a way. So overall, Hollywood, no, not that good. Scandinavian movies, yes. And that's why I don't know my favorite director or whatever, because those names are a little bit more difficult. Now, if you want to get into those movies, just email me and I will give you some really cool titles. Okay, just a question. When you resize a picture for web, why is the gradient in the back showing up? It shouldn't, Bert. If you resize in Capture One or Lightroom, there shouldn't be any gradients, in all honesty. So I think that's actually maybe
what could happen, and this is something that I did when I did it in Photoshop, make sure that you first do the conversion from color space, so from Adobe RGB to sRGB, and then go from 16 bits to 8 bits. If you do it the other way around, you will have problems with gradients. And otherwise, just add a little bit of noise and those gradients will be gone. Also, did you get inspired from cinema? Yes, a lot. When you look at my work, I think it's very, very clear that I just love movies. I just love the darker lighting. I just like storytelling. And I think that's photography, storytelling. When you look at all the years before, let's say, whenever we started doing photography, it's all about storytelling. You never just see a pretty girl. Well, some of the paintings, of course, but those were done in commission. But you never really see a pretty girl. When you look at churches, there's always like this story, Jesus or the Final Supper or whatever. There's always a story going on. Now, when you look at the last few years, we get a gazillion images uploaded every single second. It's like ridiculous. And what will we remember? The Kardashians or Duckface or whatever. And I think that's bad. So when I look at cinema, the thing that I like is storytelling. When I look at my photography, what I try to do is get a little bit of that storytelling in. But most of all, lighting. Those guys can really light a scene. Because with photography, it's easy. We just use strobes and it's one image. With movies, if a character walks, this is, by the way, a really cool one. Watch movies and you will see that when you have somebody that's walking outside in the sun, you will often see that they wear dark clothing. And also in Westerns, by the way, this, and then I will go on, but this is something that a lot of people don't realize. In Westerns, they actually made the, how do you call it, the doorposts a little bit smaller, so some actors will actually look bigger. Just so you know. Tom Cruise, by the way, does this still, but he's not that big. So, the problem in Capture One is that the picture doesn't, can make very small. In Photoshop, you can make the picture smaller for working. Hey, I don't know what you mean with that. Monique will look at that on Saturday, because in Capture One, you can literally just make the picture as small as you want. Frank, how about Jessica Jones on Netflix? You like that? Now playing season 2, it's quite dark too. Absolutely love Jessica Jones. And we're going to watch season 2 very soon, as soon as we have time. We just finished Supernatural, so it's now time for something new. And by the way, if you really want to watch a good series, watch Gotham. It's amazing. Okay, filter. Oh, I already have the filter on. I go way too fast. Change camera, of course, to my... Oops. Thank you so very much, guys, for being so interactive. That really makes my work a lot easier. Okay, hard contrast. I already like this. There we go. That's fast. Wow. Do we have something that's better? No, don't feel that one. This is what I like, by the way, about alien skin. Look at this. Now, if I just hover over the other images, it will actually just show you that image. But when I move my mouse, it will actually just show you the image I selected. If you see something that's better, like let's say I don't, but let's say you like this one better, you select it. And now when you hover over the other ones, you will actually see those. Now, as soon as you see one that's better, you click on it. It grabs it, and now you can actually just hover over the other ones. This I really like, and it renders like crazy, as you can see, really fast. Okay, so let's just flatten our image, and we're done with this one. And then we're going to do the fashion shoot, but not before. I actually have to set some stuff up, so we're going to show you a few nice little trailers. Because I have to have a little bit of a break. To get something to drink, of course. But I want to explain something, what you're going to see. Okay. Not so long ago, somebody emailed me and he said, Frank, I really like what you're doing with strobes. I really, really like your lighting. But dude, I don't have a lot of money. I actually don't have any money at all. But I still want to do photography. And I told him, listen, it's not about the camera. It's not about the lighting. Actually, you know when a photographer really, really enhances his work? It's the moment you realize it's not the camera, it's not the lighting, it's not the model, it's everything that comes together. And you can shoot it with an iPhone or a Huawei or a Note 8, it doesn't matter. You can shoot it with everything you want. As long as that story is there, you get an amazing and stunning image. A few weeks later, somebody emailed me again and I was just going like, you know what? We're going to create a video about it.
And in all honesty, I think this is one of the best videos we ever did. Now, we created a lot of instructional videos. I believe this is number 17. This one, without any doubt, get it, guys, because if you don't, you're going to miss out on a lot of information. So, here we go. The trailer, and this is actually the first time you're going to see it in a digital classroom, because it just finished like a few days ago. The trailer for Any Light Will Do. In this tutorial, we're actually going to show you that you can make great images with very, very simple tools. What to think about a tungsten light bulb. The LED panel. A ring light. A standard flashlight. The Fresnel. The Westcott Ice Light. Smartphones. The LumQ. The chandelier. Christmas lights. We call them light snakes over here. This is one of the most creative lighting videos I ever created. I'm very enthusiastic about it. It's available now via our website. See the links. Okay, as you can see, I'm literally using everything you can imagine. I'm using a torch, I'm using phones for lighting, I'm using Christmas lighting, I'm using ice lights, loom cubes, I'm using ring lights in a totally different way. Literally, this is one of the most creative videos we ever made, so make sure you check it out. And the link is actually below, as you can see. Okay, let me do one more thing. This is actually pretty cool. Now, about workshops, a lot of you guys have asked me, like, Frank, what is the best workshop we can do? And although all the workshops in the Mastering the Model shoot are cool, there's one that's really special. And on May 6th, I'm having my birthday. I'm turning 47. Oh, my. So I'm having my birthday. And the days before, 4 and 5th May, is a new ultimate weekend in our studio in Emmeloord. And this week is the final week where you can do it actually with the early bird. So you get €100 discount. It's a really intense workshop. It's from 10 till 10. It's actually from 10 till 9. But in the video, it says 10 till 10. But it's 10 to 9. We take you out for dinner. And it's actually the next day from 10 till 5. And the cool thing about this workshop is, because it's a longer workshop, you really get to connect with the other attendees, creative juices get flowing, and it's also the workshop where we go outside, we stay inside, we show you duo shoots with a model and a male model, we shoot male models, female models, it's just jam-packed. So I'm going to show you very quickly the trailer for that. And we have to do this because in between we're setting stuff up. So don't think we're doing this just to be commercial. Of course we also do that a little bit, we have to earn money. It's just awesome. And those shots is actually, well, you're going to do way better during Ultimate Weekend. Now, if you're in the Netherlands and you want to do special locations, and after this we're going to do, they're almost done, we're going to do the real photo shoot again. So if you love locations, make sure you also check out this one. It's called the Spoorweg Museum. It's actually where they have all the trains. And we're going to do a workshop there on April. As you can see, that's April 20th. I'm so sorry. Okay, guys, they are done with setups. So we're going to actually switch cameras to our setup. And you're going to see that it looks pretty simple. Let me see what we can build from this. So, okay, let me switch cameras.
And let's do the picture in picture again so you guys can actually see what I'm doing. Rosa, are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. Are you having fun?
Yeah.
You don't fall asleep yet, right? Oh, you can leave that on if you want.
Yeah?
Okay. Yeah, that's nicer. Not that the other one isn't nice, but...
I think I'm not
really okay. So, let's see if... And we can switch... let's put it a little bit more towards here. So let's just... This is, by the way, a really cool trick. We have these removable walls. Let me see if I'm in any camera. Annemiek, do you have me?
Yes.
Okay, and now one of the problems of the movable walls is actually that there's a little bit of a gap underneath. Now, this is something that you can just buy in any do-it-yourself store. I don't even know what it's called. Lambrichering or something. And that's Dutch. What, Annemiek?
Plint.
Oh, plint. It's called plint. It's Dutch. But it's universally available. And what you do is you just put it on the floor and you actually close the gap. There we go. And now on a picture, it looks nice. You don't have to do any Photoshop. Just sit down, please. Okay, so we're going to do a full body shot. And we're going to move this light much closer. And we're actually going to place it on the side of my model. Because Rosa, of course, has perfect skin. So with Rosa, we can do this. Okay, turn this one on. Now, I want to do it close to my model because I really like that light fall off. You like it when I say you have perfect skin, right?
Yeah.
I see you're smiling and... Okay, can you see through the grid?
Yes.
Still?
It's better.
Better?
Yeah.
Cool. Now, why do I ask her if she can see through the grid? Very simple, because if she can see through the grid, she's in the center of the spot. Easy. Okay, let's grab the meter. And again, you should use a color checker for your first shot, so I'm going to shoot one in a moment, just to show you guys. 8.01. Oh, let's turn off the other strobes. That helps a lot.
Thank you.
What is thank you? Oh. Okay, 5.63. Let's go up 7 clicks. 1, 2... Okay, let's end up at 8. 5.69. Okay, a little bit more. Okay, now I'm going to sit somewhere. But first we're going to shoot that color checker to explain to you guys how you shoot it. And it's actually pretty simple. You have to make sure that you light it as flat as possible. So hold it in front of your face, please. And don't cover up the little squares. But you know that, right? And I always tell my models to make a funny face, because we're going to make a book out of that. Awesomeness. Thank you so very much. I still fall for that one. Okay, cool. So now we're going to start out. I'm just going to take my chair, and I'm going to sit on a low angle. And let me see if the cameras can grab me. Probably they can. I'm going to shoot low angle. I'm going to zoom all the way in because I do want to have my whole backdrop in. Okay, I'm not going to do the full backdrop as I can see now because for Digital Classroom, I do have to stay a little bit closer to the model than I like. Okay, really nice. And as you can see now, there is a really nice light fall off. It's really tight, but that also means that I don't see her feet. And in all honesty, I do want to see her feet because she has nice boots. Can you turn around a little bit on the chair?
Okay.
Yeah, and just put your feet on the chair.
On the chair.
Yep. Yeah, we didn't agree that in our agreement, right? There we go. Nice. There we go. Okay. Now, as you can see, it's really nice, but it's pretty dark, right? And can you look towards the light source? Oh, that's awesome. I actually like the whole shot, it's just too dark. And again, I like darkness, but this is just too much. So I'm going to use a technique called light in light. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take a very, very simple light source. And it can actually be, for example, this one. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to place that behind my original light source. So
So I'm going to place it here. I have to make sure that I don't have any shadows. So I'm going to place it pretty close by. I'm going to aim it down. And I'm going to turn it on the lowest setting. Okay, there we go. It's on the lowest setting. Now, what I have to do is actually I'm going to meter that light. Now, in the white backdrop, you saw that when we go 4 stops over, or in theory 2.5, that backdrop will be absolutely white. In theory, for black, it's the other way around. Only it's 4.5 stops calculated. So that means 18, 9, 4.5, 2.2, 1.1, and one stop more, we actually go to pure black. If you want to know more about that, make sure you check out our video, The Essential Lighting Techniques. Yes, Annewiek? Then move the camera back. Oh, so I have to move back. Okay. So, the moment that you just change that around, and you add that lighting, I have to do a remetering. So we're going to take the light meter and I'm going to make sure that I know I'm shooting on F8. So if I close down 4 stops, where do I end up? Well, we're going to do this very, very simple. F8, 5.6, 4, 2.8. So let's say that you want somewhere lower than 2.8, but you want to stay above 2.0 because at 2.0 it will be too dark. So we're going to aim between 2.8 and, well, a little bit higher, a little bit lower, but around that area. So I'm going to grab the meter. Now, of course, you can do this with a reflective meter. But in this case, because he's wearing black, I can actually get away with it with incident. So I'm shooting F8. I want to make sure that it's darker. So let's meter here, the lowest part, 5.60. Now, if I turn off this one, what will be the meter reading? Because then I have my nice base. 5.60. Now, what does that tell me? This light is too bright. Ooh, that's a problem. Because, let me put it this way. You don't have any money left for modifiers because you bought all my instructional videos, you went to the Ultimate Weekend, you did the location workshop. You don't have any money left for, although we're very, very nicely priced, you don't have any money left. What do? You can actually feather lighting. So what I can do is I can actually just move this light away, as you can see here, and I can meter again, because now I'm using the sides of the light, and it gives me way less power. I'm now at 4.03. Just move it further away. 1.45. And this way you save a lot of money by just understanding what lighting does. 2.05. So just aim it a little bit back. And you see it's ridiculous, it just aimed straight at me. 2.81. Now I should get a nicer look. Okay. So let's grab the camera again. Nice. I'm going to zoom in a little bit more. And there we go. So now I opened up the shadows. It's still a really dark shot. But now you can actually see the chair. You can see your feet. And now if your client wants a little bit more and you're actually on a location, what you can do is just raise your lower your shutter speed to let in more ambient light. In this case, if your client wants more, don't never ever start twisting the light, because then you can't go back, because it's very difficult to remember what the angle was. So if your client says, "Oh, Frank, can I get a little bit more?" Just do it with power. Let's say he wants to stop more. There we go. Because the power is the same. Power has the same influence as it has normally. I hope that makes any sense. So now we're opening up a little more. Really love this. Nice. Awesome. What you can also do with sets like this is actually go really close to your model, sit on the floor, and because it's a really dark area, you can actually create some really cool effects. There we go. Can you look down? Can you look a little bit there? Love it. Really nice. Great. Okay, in different poses, try a little bit. nice. Okay, I'll just move a little bit back. We call this cleaning the floor technique. Nice. Chin up just a little bit. And some people go like, hey, you're shooting up her nose. Well, yeah. But that's when you shoot lower angles. Chin down just a lot. There we go. Awesome. And now, because she has really dark eyes, what would really help with this shot is actually sunglasses, which we didn't bring at the moment, so just chin up. There we go. Now we have light on our eyes again. Really cool. Awesome. Thank you so very much. Let's see what we can do in Photoshop with this and do the photo critiques. Give a hand of applause for Rosa. Thank you so very much, Rosa. Cool. Okay, let's switch over to the picture in picture. Now, of course, we're going to do the retouching also. Oh, that's the wrong one. I need that one. And then I need my own face in the picture. There we go. Cool. Oh, we've got a lot of questions. One moment. Frank, you sound like Mike Oldfield introducing instruments in Tubular Bell with a trailer. You know, I love audio and video. And one of the things that always just gives me goosebumps, and I don't want to say I don't like Mike Oldfield, but it's not my kind of music. But there's this song that they do live where they actually told like there's somebody moving over the mountain to the sound of tubular bells. And then they start hitting those bells. Even when I tell about it, it's just... the hairs of my beard are standing up. It's just awesome. That piece of music is... We heard it for the first time on a home theater system. Our own home theater system with a big subwoofer. And I believe it came from a super audio CD or whatever. But it was just amazing. And later we saw the live broadcast. And it was... So Mike Oldfield, Tubular Bells, The Exorcist. Yes. Awesome piece of music. Frank saw your in your latest workshop video, you used a kind of willow vintage backdrop. Really like that one. It's great for fashion. So I bought the X-Drop backdrop. I don't know what you're talking about, but if you email me, I will literally just say which backdrops I use. But I don't remember a willow vintage because I don't have a willow vintage. What we actually use here is wallpaper or painted walls, or we actually use our Lustolite panoramic backdrop. Let me see. If you ever look for a nice workshop place in Utrecht, I hire my studio in an old school. Can always talk about that. We always love locations. If second light is for fill, why don't you place it behind you? Also for fill light, why don't you use big soft light? Okay, there we go. Why didn't I place that fill light behind me? Very simple. The main light was under... Let me change this to the big camera. One moment, guys. That's the thing about a live show. Sometimes the cameras aren't perfect. So... If I place my lighting under a different angle, what will happen? So let's say we have light coming from here and we have light coming from here. You have two distinct shadows. You don't want that. You don't want two distinct shadows. Now, of course, when you place light behind it, that shadow will actually just cohere with the... Sounds like magic, but hey, you know what I mean. It just coheres with the other... With the other shadow. So that way you don't see that you use two lighting. You just see that it's a little bit more white. Which you can also say, some people will go like, hey Frank, why don't you just remove the grid from the beauty dish? Very simple, then I have too much light. I still want to be able to steer that light. So that center part has to be hot. In other words, way more light output. And then it falls back to the dark. But sometimes the dark is just too dark. So you just open it up a little bit. Now the other thing is, why don't you use a softbox? Sure, we can use a softbox, but the story was we don't have a softbox here because we don't have any budget for it. Or maybe you only have one softbox and that's the one that you have on your model and you still want to use that lighting light techniques. You can do it with anything. You can even use it with a bare strobe, just as long as you aim it away correctly. Okay. If you put a grid on the second fill-in light and place it a bit further away, can you also reduce that light? Yes, but then you also remove the spread of that light. So I wouldn't do it with a grid. My fill-in lights are normally like a 1.5 meter softbox or an umbrella or whatever, as long as it's bright. And sorry, as long as it's white. So a broad light source. That was the word I was looking for. Somebody says, bravo, Rosa. Yeah, she's awesome. Okay. Let's do the photo critiques first or the retouching. Let's do the photo critiques first. Okay, we're going to switch over to the desktop. And there we go. Okay, photo critiques. Let me open it very quickly on my desktop. Where is it? Okay, it's in Dropbox. Review. Okay, we're going to take one and two. And three. And then open it up in Photoshop. Okay. Okay, there we go. Okay, first image. Second image and third one. Okay, this is what I meant when I started with the white backdrops. If you overdo it, you will actually see that it eats away your image quality. So if I go to 100% here, now I like the shot, but do you see that there's this little blotchiness on top? So if you would have turned that backdrop just a slightly lower, you can actually see that this, and this is 100%. So if you have the image, if this is your image, and you say, hey Frank, I have more detail than you see now, then I didn't say this. But you can literally see that here it's a little bit blocky. So there's a lot of squares, blockies. I don't know if that translates well, but you know what I mean, right? So it's a little bit blown out. It doesn't look like natural hair. So when you just lower the light on the backdrop a little bit, it also makes it easier to create that silhouette. Now, the thing that I don't like in this case is actually the composition. Now, for me, it's not like I want to have it on two-thirds. I don't want the golden ratio, but what I would like to see with this one, and let me just do it very quickly, is just have a different composition. And it can be because I love movies, right? So let me go to image, let me go to canvas size, just for fun at the moment, do percentage, do width, do 300%, why not? And just move it here. There we go. Okay, view fit on screen. Now I already like this more. But what you could actually do is, we all know that there's a top on the knife. Why not just do it like this? There we go. This creates a totally different look. And for me, this just works way better. And this is one of the things that I did wrong so many times when I started out. I wanted to show everything. I wanted to show that my model had a top of her head. I wanted to show that the headpiece was all the way around. And at one point, you were just cramming in way too much information in that frame. Your mind will literally just make up what's there. So if you see that knife, my mind will make up that there's the top of the knife. If you see that his head is topped off, don't worry. Your head will make that up. So this for me looks way better. But again, that's 100% personal. Okay, so let's do this one. I really like the shot. Let me put that one. But I think you could do way better with retouching. Now watch this. The first thing, of course, is skin. So let's go to portrait smooth. And don't overdo it because this is not my shot. So I'm gonna imagine that the photographer liked this look. So I'm gonna put it all the way down to 33. Now on the legs, I always want it a little bit softer. So everything else, like arms and legs, softer. But the face, I won't do a lot about. So there we go. It's very rough. But the legs just look way better if they're a little bit smoother. Okay, now do layer, flatten image. Now what I like, and I'm going to show you this with Topaz. And Topaz really has cool filters. We have a discount page on our website, frankdorff.com/discounts. I believe, discount, just look on the website. And they have this really cool filter, and it's called clarity and structure. So they have two. And in this case, I think I'm gonna go for detail. Now, what I wanna do is I wanna make that backdrop really pop. So here we go. It's analyzing the image. It has artificial intelligence, so that's why it does this. So let's just pop detail or just do hyper. No, that's too much. Do this. Okay, so I really pop the backdrop now. Press apply. Okay, cool. And then okay. Cool. Now see the difference. You see that there's a lot more structure now in the backdrop. Of course, you don't want it everywhere, but I'm not going to do this really nice. So sorry, guys. Just do it. Do a reveal all. Take your brush, and of course, you have to do this way nicer than I do now. Just take everywhere where you don't want that effect in. Just take it out. And again, do this nicer than I'm doing it now. Okay, cool. Nice. Okay, see the difference? And when I go to 100%, you can actually see it way better. It just really makes that image pop. And this was Topaz detail. Now, if I look at the shot, I really like it, but I think it can do a little bit more in looks. So let's go layer, flatten image. Where can you send the images? You can just send in a picture to info@frankdorhoff.com and just make sure that it's addressed to me and that you want it for a review. And then next time, maybe you'll see your image. And if it's an image from Bert, I'm pretty sure he will see a review of his image. Okay, so this is a really cool trick. Do a layer, new layer. Okay. Go to your bottom layer and go to channels and pick the red channel. Now you can see that her skin really, really loves that red channel. If you go to the blue one, not so much. If you go to the green one, okay. But if you go to the red one, oh, this is really cool for skin. And that's actually what you have to remember. Also, when you do black and white conversions, if you pump that red channel, you will get beautiful, beautiful skin. Okay, so let's do this. Edit. Select all. Edit, copy. And go back to layers and go to your top layer. Edit, paste. There we go. And now what you do is you choose soft light. And look at the difference. Before, after. Before, after. Really like this. Now, I don't want to do it with tinting because, with filters because maybe you don't have those filters. I'm going to show you another really cool one. Just go into layers. We already did the curves one, so let's do this one. Okay. Bye, Rosa. So do this, and let's give it a blue tint, because I think this is really a blue image. And let's go to really blue. There we go. And I'll do the same thing, only now choose, for example, lumosity. Nope, sorry. Saturation. Nope, sorry. Color. Nope, sorry, something else. You know what I'm doing, right? I'm just having fun with you guys. What you do is you go through all these, and what you can do is do it with your cursor keys. You just go through and you just find the one that you really like. Now in my case, that's often, I have to be honest with you guys, soft light. It's somehow the one that I really like. But as you can see, all the effects, and at one point you will literally start to recognize the effects you get. So hard light, vivid light, too much, soft light, really cool. So let's do it on soft light. And then just change the opacity all the way to zero and then gradually build it up. There we go. Okay. Now let's say that we want a little bit of lighting effect on this one. Because, well, it's an image of a model. Let's do a little bit of lighting effects. Layer. New layer. There we go. Just make it smaller a little bit. Okay. I did something wrong. Sorry. Layer. New layer. And just do mode soft light. And fill with neutral gray. There we go. So now we have a layer that does absolutely nothing. And I love those. Go to your rectangular marquee and change it for a circle. And just drag it around your model like this. Select. Modify. Feather. And do it like 200. Because this is not a full size resolution image. Select inverse. And now take your bucket. Fill it with black paint. It's so easy in Photoshop. And just fill it. And there you go. And now you have a little bit of an effect like you used a beauty dish with a grid. And I think overall this really helps the shot. And again, if you don't like the blue tinting, just change it to something else. It doesn't matter. I just want to show you very quickly what you can change in those images. Okay, final one. Same here. I really like the shot. I really like the overall look. I'm not a big fan of smokers, but hey, I'm sorry if I offend you, by the way. It was not meant that way. Let me do something really fast. Let's go into Luminar. Let's do this one in Luminar. Okay. And go to my presets. And let me see. First, I'm going to determine the look, for example, blue film. Oh, yeah, I really like this. You see how gritty it becomes? Really like that. Okay. And then what I like to do is just add a little bit of clarity. There we go. Just look at the difference. Cool. And just press apply. So this is what I mean with storytelling. Now, the shot as it was before, it was straight out of the camera and there's no tinting. And I think when you look at movies like, for example, Titanic, Saving Private Ryan, The Matrix, The Abyss, it's all done with tinting. Tinting is a mood maker. If you don't tint your images and you get them straight out of the camera, those are great beauty shots or great shots for a commercial campaign or whatever. But if you want to really touch the emotion, that sounds really deep, but if you want to touch the emotion of your viewer, make sure that you use tinting, because tinting is just, it's just awesome. So as you can see, a totally, totally different shot now. And in my opinion, way better. Because the image is already there. Just finish it. Look, before, after, before, after. And again, if you like it red, make it red. If you like it blue, just do it like that. And now I want some extra attention. Drum roll, please. Because I have got something incredibly cool. Now, a while ago, I did a digital classroom, and we will link that digital classroom below, so anyone can remember that. And that digital classroom was not about model photography. It was actually about product photography, and in that case, Batman. So what did I do? I brought Batman in the studio, and I actually teased about it already with showing the logo very, very dark. But it was a doll. And at one point, I just started shooting it, and I think it inspired a lot of people like, hey, we can use that modeling lighting for something like for selling it on eBay. Now, I hope this guy doesn't sell his Batman doll on eBay, but I got this amazing stuff in. And this is from Michael, and or Michael, it's German, so probably Michael. And in all honesty, it just blew my mind. And the cool thing is that sometimes people ask me, like, what do you like so much about teaching? Because you can be a successful photographer if you don't teach. I know, but I just love teaching. I love telling you guys the stories behind the images. I love inspiring you guys. And then when I get images that are inspired by something that I do, I'm just very proud. I was smiling smiling like crazy when I got these. So watch this. So I also love the light blaster. So what did Michael did? He actually bought a light blaster and put Batman in front of it. No, it's Michael.
He brought the light blaster from us.
Oh, he brought the light blaster from us. Yes, we sell them too. So I just think this is freaking awesome, because this is also one of the slides. And this is the cool thing. This is one of the slides that I also use a lot. So it has so many connections. So I really love this shot. And this is probably his clock. So this is, I think this shouldn't be in here, but if you on screen. So I really like this one in the forest. Look at the shadow and the lighting, and the light blaster just does an amazing job. I'm not so sure about the shadow here, because now you can actually see that it's a light blaster, but hey, I still like it. And by the way, how can you take that shadow out? Very, very simple. Place the light higher. Your main light on your model, place it higher, so the shadow will actually be lower. And finally, he also used some smoke. I'm so proud. I really like this. The only thing I would do with this one, actually, is just go into image adjustments, curves, and just make it a little bit darker. And just aim a little bit up. There we go. And because you're pushing it, it will actually mean that there's a little bit more saturation. So go to image adjustments, saturation, just pull the saturation down just a little bit. There we go. And by the way, just take out the corner here. That's a little bit, there's a little bit of debris there. I really like this. Okay, so the images from Rosa. So no story. Let me go very quickly through them. And in all honesty, we don't need a lot of shots. And I just want to show you how we build it up. So we have this one. Too dark in the eyes. Too dark. I really like this one, but it's too dark on her body. So I'm going to delete these. And here we open it up. Do you see the difference? It's just a very simple extra strobe, light in light. And you don't see any difference in the shadow hardly. It's because she's actually moving around a little bit. So you can see here it's more opened up. Okay. Now, as you can see here, I'm choosing the safe position. And that never gives you the cool shots. It will give you the shot that your client hires you for. But it's never that, oh wow, look at this shot. That shot will actually happen when you start to being a little bit more creative and actually sit down on the floor, although it looks funny. But now you actually get these really, really cool shots. Now get in the feet. There we go. Oh, really like this. And not too dark. And there we go. Only have one. That's more than enough. Go here. And go here. Now, of course, you can say, hey, Frank, why didn't you just open up the shadows in Capture One for this shot? Yeah, well, you can do that. But I always believe that if you use lighting, it just looks more natural. But if you want, you can still open up the shadows just a little bit. There we go. Now, in my case, I like it a little bit darker. But let's just, for the sake of arguments, let's open it up. There we go. Now, first, let's see how we remove this, because this looks like an absolute nightmare. So open up Photoshop. A little bit of a drink. Anyway, do we have any questions on Facebook?
No.
Oh, wow. Normally, Facebook is very active and YouTube is very slow. And now YouTube is incredibly active and Facebook is slow. Go figure.
There's a question on YouTube.
Oh, there's a question on YouTube? Where's the question on YouTube? Yeah, where can I send in a picture? I already discussed that. Okay. So, in this case, I have to trust on Content Aware Fill, because you can never clone this. So you can, but it's a lot of work. And again, I'm very lazy. So I'm just going to do this, and I'm going to delete Content Aware Fill. And it will do an okay job. And in a moment, I'm going to show you the final solution. So I'm going to do the same here. I always am surprised how Adobe figures this out, because this is just bordering on pure magic. So it's really cool. Okay, here we have a problem. Just take that one out. Now, you and I can see that the patterns aren't 100% correct. It's a little bit where you go like, I don't know. So what do you do to solve that? Very simple. I already showed you the technique in a previous image. Now what I do, by the way, is I have to straighten this. Now I'm losing a little bit of her face. So I'm actually making my crop somewhat tighter. Less tight. And I'm actually going to use... Oh, sorry, guys. I'm actually going to use Content Aware also on the top part. There we go. This is why you should always make sure that you hold your camera correct while shooting it. Because now you can see what happens. Okay. Content of the film. Nice. Okay, select, deselect. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do exactly the same as I did before. Layer, new layer. Choose soft light, neutral gray. I'm going to pick my marquee tool in round. I'm going to do, let me make it really tight. There we go. Select modify feather and let's do it really wide. So let's do 800. Yeah, that's cool. Select invert. And there we go. So now it doesn't really scream out like, hey, your patterns are wrong, because you actually hide it. And that's the cool thing. This is something that they also use a lot in movies. If you don't want to see it, just hide it. Like, why do you think a lot of movie posters don't have the feet of the character on the floor? Because it's way too difficult. So they cut off, or they shoot them, of course, on location. But if they do those compositing, you will never see the feet hitting the floor unless there's a lot of budget. because, well, it's difficult. So why not just cut it off? That's the same thing we do here. Just cover up the areas that are, eh, okay. But I did do before, because, now listen to this, and this is really important to remember. Some people will say, why did you do content-aware fill if you already know you're going to make it darker? This is incredibly important to understand. Our mind or our photographer's eyes will still see through those shadows. If we don't see any detail there, it's alarm lights will go off like, hey, what's going on, dude? Did you forget something? If you just make sure that there's detail there and it's just not connected, because it's dark, your eyes will go like, well, there's detail there, done. So it won't analyze the whole picture. That's just how our eyes work. So if I pull it back, I will just find a way where I don't find that I see any loss of detail. There we go. So this is cool. Okay. Layer, flatten image. Okay, do the portrait smooth. So that's my image normal portraiture. Now one could argue about the white on the bottom. I don't really mind it, but you could take it out if you want. Okay. Won't keep you guys any longer than necessary, so I'm gonna do this fast. Layer, flatten image, and in this case I want a very subtle tinting, and as I told you before, with subtle tinting I go to alien skin. So we go to exposure X3, which is the newest version. And let's just go through some tintings. Oh, really like this. It's very, very natural. It gives me a slight change. So I don't want to do too much with this image because it already looks pretty good. I just like those warm tints. Yep, just leave it like this. Just gives it a little bit more pop. Now, if you want those shoes to stand out a little bit more, what you can do, and it's a quick and easy fix. So let's just first do this, flatten image and create one more. Just use your dodge tool and use it on highlights and just put it all the way up like 46% and just go over the shoes, and it will really make those shoes stand out. Or even her trousers or her leather jacket. Now it looks like I don't do a lot, but just wait a minute. Let me show you before and after. It just really enhances the image for me, so I really, really like that. It's like hitting that like button, because we really like that. Okay, do the flatten image, and file close. Okay, so in today's episode, what we did is actually show you everything about how you can just play around with your lighting and do all the other funky stuff. Now, we did a video on that too, of course. And you can actually get that also on our website. And I do want to show you, and after that we'll back with some really cool news. So let me show you that one pretty fast. There we go.
My name is Frank Doorhoff, and I'm a fashion celebrity photographer based in the Netherlands. But most of all, I love teaching you guys about photography. Now, what is the main ingredient of photography? The model, of course, your camera, but most of all, lighting. Photography is painting with light, telling your story with light. And so light is the most important thing in photography. But still, 99% of the photographers let the lighting control them. While in essence, you as a photographer should be able to control the lighting. And that's why this video is created. It's a video about the essential lighting techniques, the lighting techniques that you should learn. How to create a white backdrop, or how to create a black backdrop. How to make sure that there's still shadow in your lighting. But most of all, how about the essential lighting, like Rembrandt, butterfly, feathering your light, making sure that your model is lit the correct way. In this video, we're gonna do all those techniques. And way more. Very simple tips about how to control your shadows. We talk about light meters. We talk about my favorite plugins. If you're a starting photographer, this is the video for you. This is where you learn everything you need to know about lighting. And after that, you can start telling your story with great lighting. If you're a professional, I'm sure there are a lot of tips in here that also help you. So enjoy our new instructional video, available now.
Okay, that's without any doubt a very, very interesting video for if you're just starting out with photography or you want to know more about photography. Now, the next digital classroom is actually on May 9th, and I'm going to need your help for that one. Because the next one, you guys are going to determine what I'm going to do. Send in your questions, send in your suggestions, and send in whatever you want to see. But also send in some images for critique, because the next one, it's all about you guys. So we're gonna do that one probably with a model, but we can also do it with the computer. So if you like the episodes where I was actually going like, okay, so this is the story behind the image, just send those in, because we're gonna make a mix of that. Now there's one thing I do wanna ask you guys. Now, I didn't wanna do this at first, but later on I decided let's do that. There's a website called Patreon, and Patreon is somewhere where you can actually show your appreciation for what we do. And the appreciation starts with $1 a month, or $5, or $10. Now, you saw the photo critiques I did before, right? So I take a lot of time and just showing you like what I should retouch or what I should change. Now, when you join our Patreon, we have a so-called bat phone. Okay. We like Batman. So anyway, we have that bat phone, and that's a Facebook group with a chat room, where you can actually just ask questions and the whole community just interacts with each other, shows images, talk about the images, and I'm there literally like two or three times a day. We also do behind the scenes images, which you normally don't get on social media, like if we go to a flea market, we show some images, but also during, for example, a workshop. We show a lot of behind the scenes images during workshops over the year and when we're traveling. You guys on social media see a lot. Those guys actually get some extras. Plus, you get photo critiques, meaning we do a video specially for that photo, and normally it runs between 8 or 9 minutes for a photo critique. So head on over to Patreon and show your support for us. Even if you don't want all the goodies and just want to say, hey Frank, we love what you do, because you deliver everything for free, so just go to Patreon. Okay, next digital classroom was May 9th. That's right after the Ultimate Weekend, so that's going to be interesting. And right after my birthday, that's going to be really bad. Let me see. Cool, my first digital classroom live. Good to have you, Glam and Grunge Video Studio. Sorry. Any more questions on Facebook, Anouk?
No.
Then from my side, I'd like to thank very much our sponsors, Rogue and BenQ. Because without you guys, digital classroom wouldn't be possible. So a hand of applause for BenQ and Rogue. You guys rock. See you again next time. And well, again, email me if you have any questions. And you know the email, right? info@frankdorhoff.com. But most of all, tell other people about our channel, because we really want to grow that YouTube channel for you guys. See you again next time. Bye-bye.